Okay, we're in the final stretch. Anybody ever used to run track and field here?
I hate it.
Even? What'd you run? 100, 200. Yeah, too short, won't work for my analogy, but what'd you used to run? A mile and 2 mile. And what happens in the bell lap? Races are won or lost, right? So this is the bell lap for us, guys. It's the last lap. You know, we've done 3 laps or 4 laps. This is the last one. And we can bring this in hard and run a good race, or we can drift into la-la land and miss what God wants to do. So how many of you want to punch over this finish line with a lot of energy? Can I get a yeah? All right. Okay, well then, let's do it. Crank that volume.
Rise and shine. 6 a.m. and your hand can't make it to the alarm clock before the voices in your head start telling you that it's too early, too dark, and too cold to get out of bed. Aching muscles lie still in rebellion, pretending not to hear your brain commanding them to move. A legion of voices are shouting their unanimous permission for you to hit the snooze button and go back to dreamland. But you didn't ask their opinion. The voice you've chosen to listen to is one of defiance. A voice that says there was a reason you set that alarm in the first place. So sit up, put your feet on the floor, and don't look back, because we've got work to do. Welcome to the grind. For what is each day but a series of conflicts between the right way and the easy way? 10,000 streams fan out like a river delta before you, each one promising the path of least resistance. Thing is, you're headed upstream. And when you make that choice, when you decide to turn your back on what's comfortable and safe and what some would call common sense, well, that's day one. From there, it only gets tougher. So just make sure this is something you want, because the easy way out will always be there, ready to wash it away. All you have to do is pick up your feet. But you aren't going to, are you? With each step comes the decision to take another. You're on your way now, but this is no time to dwell on how far you've come. You're in a fight against an opponent you can't see, but oh, you can feel him on your heels, can't you? Feel him breathing down your neck. You know what that is? That's you. Your fears, your doubts, and insecurities all lined up like a firing squad, ready to shoot you out of the sky. But don't lose heart. While they're not easily defeated, they are far from invincible. Remember, this is the grind. The battle royale between you and your mind, your body, and the devil on your shoulder is telling you that this is just a game. This is just a waste of time. Your opponents are stronger than you. Drown out the voice of uncertainty with the sound of your own heartbeat. Burn away your self-doubt with the fire that beneath you. Remember what we're fighting for, and never forget that momentum is a cruel mistress. She can turn on a dime with the smallest mistake. She is ever searching for the weak place in your armor, that one tiny thing you forgot to prepare for. So as long as the devil is hiding the details, the question remains, is that all you got? Are you sure? And when the answer is yes, and you've done all you can to prepare yourself for battle, then it's time to go forth and boldly face your enemy, the enemy within. Only now you must take that fight into the open, into hostile territory. You're a lion in a field of lions, all hunting the same elusive prey with a desperate starvation that says victory is the only thing that can keep you alive. So believe that voice that says you can run a little faster, and you can throw a little harder, and that for you, the laws of physics are merely a suggestion. Luck is the last dying wish of those who want to believe that winning can happen by accident. Sweat, on the other hand, is for those who know it's a choice. So decide now, because destiny waits for no man. And when your time comes, and 1,000 different voices are trying to tell you you're not ready for it, listen instead to that lone voice of dissent. The one that says you are ready, you are prepared. It's all up to you now. So rise and shine.
Isn't that good? So guys, there's 2 pedals on the bike we ride. 1 pedal is personal responsibility. We need to rise and shine. Welcome to the grind. We need to do what we need to do. We need to ante up. We need to step up. We need to step out. We need to call ourselves up. We need to work. We need to train, we need to persevere and push ourselves to discover our greatness. We need to study, we need to memorize, we need to meditate, we need to discuss, we need to disciple, we need to get engaged. That's 1 pedal on the bike. It's up to us to carry our personal responsibility. The other pedal on the bike is the sovereignty of God, that he will initiate on our behalf because he loves us. He's going to speak. He's going to lead. He promises in Psalm 32, verse 8, I will lead you and guide you in the way that you should go. I will counsel you and watch over you. He promises in Philippians 4, 19, I will provide for all of your needs according to my riches and glory in Christ Jesus. He promises nothing can separate us from his love. He promises he's never forsaken those who've trusted in him. The divine sovereignty of God. And we have a responsibility. 1 Timothy 4, verse 7 to 8. Train yourself to be godly. For physical training is of some value. That whole Nike commercial. There's value in that. But godliness has value for all things, holding promise for both the present life and the life to come. Hebrews 12, verse 1. No discipline seems pleasant at the time, but painful. Later on, however, it produces a harvest of righteousness and peace for those who've been trained by it. This requires effort. You want to get a hold of the truth that God has for you. You want to discover your greatness in him, your glory that Jesus has for you. Jesus said, Father, I've given them the glory that you gave me. There's a glory that each one of us has, that God has given to us, that he's called us into. It takes effort to get a hold of that. There is a cost and a price to be paid. And that's in surrender, and submission, and obedience, and perseverance, and humility. And as we do that, Scripture even tells us, the Lord says, the Holy Spirit, the Lord makes us willing and able to work according to his good pleasure. Because he's prepared good works in advance for us to walk in. So he says, I've prepared all this great stuff, this good work for you to walk in. I'm going to provide for all of your needs. I will never leave you or forsake you. Nothing can separate you from my love. And I even work in you to make you willing and able to work according to what I've called you to. But he needs us to say, okay, Lord, I'm in. I'm getting up at 5:01 when you rouse me to spend time with you. I'm going to begin to focus on truth, to memorize truth, to meditate on truth. I'm going to begin to engage and interact. And like Greg said, what's going to happen out of today if we don't take action? Nothing. It'd be the same thing. You'll always get what you've always gotten because you'll always do what you've always done. Unless we take action out of today and do something different. So I want to show you another clip. Hopefully it will stir your heart.
We hope every seat is full. We hope you hear them cheer for everyone but you. We hope defeat is in your cards. We hope your hope splinters into shards that you must handpick from the bleeding wound of your defeat. We hope that every athlete you meet is better, more determined than you. Because you need to be tested the same way wrong needs right, the same way roar needs fight. You must fight to be here. You must pay with sacrifice. You must disregard the price of admission. If you want in, it will cost you. It will cost you broken bones and blood. We hope for a flash flood of fear and uncertainty. We wish this misery upon you because it gives birth to brilliance. There will be a moment in which everything you want becomes a singular goal. A moment of debt when every heartbeat you own can't pay for every breath you stole. You must pay with the whole of you. Because this is the price and these are the stakes. You must pay for all the hurts and all the aches. You must open your heart like a vault and pay for your pain because this is what it takes.
Commercial. And what does Paul have to say in Philippians 3? Not that I've already obtained all this, or I've already arrived at my goal, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. Brothers, I do not regard myself yet as having taken hold of it, but one thing I do. Forget what is behind. Forget the failures. Forget how you've disappointed. Forget how you've screwed up. Lay aside the sin that so easily besets you. Forget what's behind and strain toward what is ahead. Press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called us heavenward in Jesus. He's worth our effort.
Amen.
So, this session is about how do I live differently. We call it the five fundamentals. And here's how we came up with it. Let's pick a losing hockey team.
Vancouver.
Yep. So I would bet the coach of the Canucks at some point in time is saying, you know what, we got to get back to the fundamentals of good hockey. You guys are not mastering the fundamentals of this game. And there's no way you can be champions if you can't master the fundamentals. If you want to win, you need to master the fundamentals of this game. And I believe our walk with Jesus is similar. What are the fundamentals to our game? What does it take for us to be victorious in Him? For us to live the life that He's called us to live? For us to walk in the greatness and the glory? For us to work through the things that trip us up, and the failures and the disappointments, to rise up out of the muck, to continue to grow in Him and move forward to a latter glory that's greater than a former glory? What are the fundamentals we need to walk in? And I boiled it down to five that I believe are the core fundamentals for us to live a godly life. Here's the five fundamentals. One, courage. Two, confession. Three, communion. Four, community. Five, combat. Courage, confession, communion, community, combat. Five fundamentals that we need to master to live a godly life. Okay, let's look at the first one. Courage. 1 Corinthians 16, verse 13 and 14. Be on your guard. Stand firm in the faith. Be courageous. Be strong. Do everything in love. Joshua 1, 9. Have I not commanded you, be strong and courageous? Don't be afraid. Don't be discouraged. The Lord your God is with you wherever you go. I want to define courage for you. Courage is not the absence of fear. Courage is not being fearless. Fear, is actually the prerequisite for courage. If you are not afraid, you don't need courage, do you? Right? As soon as you're afraid, I need courage now. And John Wayne, to me, has the best definition of courage. He said, courage is being scared spitless, but saddling up anyways. Courage is pushing through fear. Cowardice is caving in to fear. So fear is the prerequisite for living a courageous life. This is not a good prayer. Lord, give me courage. Yeah, He'll put things in your life that threaten you beyond belief, that intimidate you and overwhelm you, so that we can choose courage. Because courage is not a gift. God doesn't give you courage. Courage is a choice. It's an act of your will. How many of you don't have a will? We all have a will, right? God, the greatest gift, the greatest weapon God's given us is our will. Courage is a choice to keep moving forward in the face of fear. That's all it is. So when you feel afraid or intimidated, you go, this is my time to shine. I can be courageous. And you keep moving forward. That's courageous. It's a choice. You can't pray for courage. You can choose courage. That's why God says to Joshua, have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. He didn't say, I'll give you courage, Joshua. No, you be courageous. Make the choice. I am with you, so go for it. You may be scared spitless, saddle up anyways. There's no way we can follow God if we're not willing to take courage, right? How many of you, when we went out for the covenant of violence, and you were looking at the lies, and it was time to deal with them, you felt intimidated? Nobody felt intimidated? Yeah, takes courage, right? Right, Maureen?
Yeah.
Takes courage to say, no, okay, I'm going to push through this. There's no way we can follow God into the promised land if we're not willing to take courage and face our fears, whatever they may be. So I believe first thing we need is courage. Okay. Second, fundamental, confession. And this is tied up with humility. Humility is massively important because God says, well, actually, I get to this. I'm ahead of myself. The reality is, guys, you're going to mess up. How many of you can guarantee me when you leave here, you're not going to sin again? If you are, you've got a problem with pride. And God will deal with that. So, yeah, we're going to screw up, right? So, knowing we're going to screw up, what do we need to do? We talked earlier about we live a life of repentance, right? Live a life of confession. And that happens because we're choosing humility. So humility, confession, repentance is all wrapped up. So what does Scripture have to say about this? Oh, did I have Hebrews up there already? Oh, I did. Thanks. I'm thanking myself for putting that up. You're doing a great job. Well, thank you. Hebrews 12, verse 1. I love this. Therefore, since we're surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses. And do you know what that cloud of witnesses is?
Angels have been around before.
Yeah, and the angelic realm. You've got all the saints that have fought this fight before, that walked this walk, that have lived this life, that are now see the end. And they're probably going, if I only knew then what I knew now. So the cloud of witnesses and all the angelic realm. So therefore, we got this huge cloud of witnesses. What do we need to do? We need to lay aside that which hinders us and the sin that so easily entangles. And what I love about this is it's present tense. This lay aside the sin that entangles us. In other words, it's going to happen. Sin happens. Lay it aside. If we confess our sin, he's faithful and just to forgive our sin and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Right? Christ died once for all sins. So deal with it. Move on. Remember? Talking about the golf thing, adjust your stance, adjust your stroke, hit the mulligan, and swing again. Oh, crap, I shanked it again. Okay, Lord, help me. I got to adjust my grip, get some instruction on what you need to do, hit the mully, try it again. Whoa, I got it right that time. Awesome. Lay aside the sin that entangles us and keep running the race. What are we doing? We're fixing our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross and suffered the shame. Do you know what the joy before Jesus was? Us. Mm-hmm. Us. It's you and me. Jesus says, I'm going to birth a people that are free, that are set free of the bully, the enemy, who's out to steal, kill, and destroy. I'm going to break the chains that hold them to set my people free to live in the government of God, the heart of God that I created them to live in. So turn to the guy next to you and say, dude, you are the joy of the Lord. And turn to the guy on the other side and say, dude, I am the joy of the Lord. And guys, you know when we pray, you know, if we prayed we want to get the joy of the Lord, how we get the joy of the Lord is realizing we're the joy of the Lord. When we realize our Father delights in us and we are his joy, how does that make us feel? That's a happy dance right there.
Yeah,
I'm the joy of the Lord. So Jesus, for the joy set before him, endured the cross and suffered the shame. We're his joy. And that's a truth worth drilling into. So how do we live this way? Lay aside the sin that so easily entangles us and that which hinders us and keep running the race. There's only one way we can do that. Humility. 1 Peter 5, verse 5 and 6. God opposes the proud, but he shows grace to the humble. Humble yourselves, therefore, under God's mighty hand, that he might lift you up in due time. Cast all your anxiety on him, because he cares for you. Arrogance is the number one killer of godly men. Arrogance is a killer. Humility releases the grace of God. And as we're confessing our sin and repenting, that's humility. It releases the grace of God. More grace to change. More grace to believe. More grace to embrace what God has for us.
Yes.
Humility is hugely important. Walking in openness and accountability with other guys, it's humility. So, confession, repentance, humility. Second fundamental of walking with God, living a godly life. Remember that picture of the golf simulator. Hit that miraculous mulligan, the divine do-over, the spiritual start again. Don't hold grace cheaply. Do I continue in sin so that grace may abound, as Paul said?
No.
But I'm going to continue to call on the grace of God and walk in repentance, knowing that sin's going to entangle. I'm going to keep running the race, fixing my eyes on the author and perfecter of our faith. Okay, third, communion. We are created to be in relationship with God, to commune with Him. In the Garden of Eden, we got given two mandates. One was relationship. Relationship with God and relationship with each other. The second mandate was rulership, to rule, to be stewards of His, of this world, to be ambassadors of His kingdom. And then Jesus came and gave us a third mandate, and that's revolution, to lead the revolution of the kingdom of God, to restore the hearts of men and women to God. So communion is what we were created for, to commune with God, to relate with Him. Luke 4, verse 8, Jesus said, "Worship the Lord your God and serve Him only." That our lives revolve around God. Our lives are rooted in Him. He is the epicenter of all that we are. Deuteronomy 8, 3, God humbled His people, causing them to hunger, fed them with manna, to teach us that man doesn't live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God. And then again, John 15, verse 4, "Remain in me, as I remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me." And that to me says we need to stay rooted and grounded and feeding and fellowshipping with God. And we do that in myriad ways. One is diving into His scripture, getting a hold of His heart through His word. Another is through prayer. Another is through musical worship and praise. Other is just walking with Him, riding a bike with Him, riding your motorbike with Him, hiking with Him, going out in your boat, whatever it is. Invite Jesus and say, "Lord, I want to be with you," communing with Him, choosing to fellowship with Him, to talk with Him. We call that prayer. There's myriad different ways, but ensuring that we are plugged in to God, staying connected with Him, communing with Him, so we bear fruit. Fourth fundamental, community. As I said earlier, life is a team game. Following Jesus is a team game. If I stood up here and said, yeah, I play hockey, and you said to me, "Hey, Dave, what team do you play on?" And I said, "Well, I'm not on a team." What would you think? "Dude, you're such a poser. You don't play hockey." You can't play hockey unless you're on a team. It's the nature of the sport. Following Jesus is a team game. Jesus birthed a body, a people belonging to God. A man alone, as Clint Eastwood has said. Any Clint Eastwood fans in the house? Well, you know what Clint said. He said, "A man alone is easy prey. You don't want to be that man." I could do a bunch of other impersonations. But the reality is, how many guys have we seen get alone, and next thing you know, they're dead. They're gone. They're alienated and isolated. They've lost their faith, no relationship with Jesus. We got to think like the muskox. You know what the muskox do? When the wolf pack comes around, they get in a circle. Excuse me. I'm not choking on my own, whatever. Butts in, horns out. Butts in, horns out. And the young ones are in the middle.
Pretty smart.
Yeah. except for the little ones that choose not to circle up. And what do they end up?
Food.
Dinner. Yeah. Totally. We got to think that way. This is a team game, and there's a wolf pack that's out to take us down. But when we're in that circle, when we circle the wagons, butts in, horns out, we're a formidable foe. We've got to learn to live that way. Hebrews 10, let us consider how we may spur one another on to good deeds, not giving up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another, and all the more as we see the day approaching. 1 Corinthians 12:27. Now you are the body of Christ. Each one of you is part of it. Romans 12, verse 4 and 5. For just as each one of us has one body with many members, and these members do not all have the same function, so in Christ, we, though many, form one body, and each member belongs to all the others. We actually belong to each other. Just like your body, all the pieces belong together. What do you think I would feel like if one day I woke up and my gallbladder said, I'm out of here, dude? Or my bladder. That would not be good. And there's other parts of my body that would be even more horrible. We need the parts of our body working together. We, together, form a body. We need each other. And if you leave, I suffer. I need you. You need me. And we need to understand we've got a responsibility to each other to walk together. Because I can't be who I can be without you being who you can be. Mm-hmm. And you can't be who you can be without you being who you can be. We need each other. It's community. Jesus came to birth a body, a people belonging to God, that we might declare the praises of him who called us out of darkness into his wonderful light. Following Jesus is a team game. The fifth fundamental, combat. We saw today, guys, we live in a world at war. If you want to live the life, you got to fight the fight. There's only one way to live this life, and that's by fighting the fight. It's not about the fight, it's about the life. But we're not going to get the life if we're not willing to fight the fight. As we saw, James 4, verse 7, submit yourselves then to God, resist the enemy, and he will flee. Ephesians 6, 12, our struggle is not against flesh and blood. It's against rulers. It's against the authorities, the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Our enemy is defeated, but he can test that defeat, and he wants to find out if you know he's defeated. Mm-hmm. That's why we combat. And we fight for other people who don't understand yet. Amen. We fight in the spirit. We pray. And that's a whole other topic right there, learning how to fight on behalf of other people. So, let's review the five fundamentals. First fundamental is?
Courage.
Courage. Second fundamental is?
Defense.
Third fundamental is?
Communion.
Communion. Fourth fundamental?
Community.
Fifth?
Combat.
Combat. Guys, as we walk in this, courageously partnering with Jesus, confessing our failures, our sin, receiving the grace of God, walking in humility and repentance, as we commune with him and discover his heart, the truth, live lives of worship and obedience, surrender and humility, as we walk together, holding each other up, speaking encouragement into each other's lives, who we see each other is, calling out the greatness in each other and the glory, and confronting things that need to be confronted, and fighting the lies of the enemy so that we can pull up the spiritual strangler face and get the truth of God rooted in us, filled with the Holy Spirit. That's a powerful group of men. That's a powerful people.
Amen.
So we're going to finish with a video clip and a song, but I want to ask you to do something first. This is something I do with our leaders. When I'm working with my leaders, at the end of each session, we do a personal action summary. What are you going to do differently? What's the action you're going to take tomorrow from what you've learned today? So I want us to take 2 minutes right now. I want you to open up your book, and I want you to write down 3 actions you're going to take. And I want you to get really specific. Really specific. And if, you know, not, well, I'm going to pray more. No. I want you to get really specific. What does that look like? I'm going to set my alarm clock half an hour earlier, 3 days a week, 5 days a week, seven, whatever, and I'm going to spend 15 minutes for a walk to pray with the Lord, whatever, I don't know. You decide, what are you going to do out of today that's going to create change in your life? Three actions. Maybe I'm going to start to write out my book of lies. I'm going to flesh that out more. I'm going to walk through the tools of truth in each one of the lies in my life. Three actions you're going to take. Set up a breakfast once a week where we talk about the stuff we've learned today. It may be, I'm going to commit to be at the Riverside Men's breakfast. It may be, I'm going to walk through this with my wife and pray for each other to discover what are the lies that we've each believed. Before the Lord. Finish up, and we're finishing with a video. And those of you who've been to a boot camp know what's coming. I just can't think of a better way to finish off a men's event. We've got the final scene from Braveheart.
Yeah.
And then we've got a song after that. And I want you to see this through different eyes, if you haven't seen it lately, or you've seen it previously. Here's the lenses through which I want you to look at this. This clip is of William Wallace, who is a freedom fighter for Scotland, to fight for the freedom of Scotland from the English domination. And he ended up sacrificing his life so his people could be free. And Robert the Bruce actually led the Scots on the fields of Bannockburn in 1314 to victory over the English. And we've been on the fields of Bannockburn, and there's a statue there that says, it's not for glory nor honor for riches, but only alone we fight for freedom, which no good man surrenders but with his life. Mm. And this is the scene where Wallace has been captured, and he's tortured, and he's killed. And Jesus was captured and tortured and killed so that we might be free. It is for freedom that Christ has set us free.
Yes.
So I want you to watch what's being done to Wallace here through the lens of, Lord Jesus, what did you do for us? What did you go through to set us free? And now what is our response to that? Will we rush the field as an army together to defeat the oppression in our lives so that we can truly be free men in you. And then you can express your heart about that in the song that follows the clip.
Patriots of Scotland, starving and outnumbered, charged the fields of Bannockburn. They fought like warrior poets. They fought like Scotsmen. And won their freedom. Thank you.
Father, we thank you that you have called us your beloved sons. Jesus, we thank you that you have made a way for us to be adopted into, to be born again into the family of God. And Holy Spirit, we thank you that you fill us, you infuse every cell, every fiber of our being, that we might partner with God in this epic adventure called the government of God in us and through us, to see our lives transformed and the lives of others transformed. We love you, Lord. We ask that you would continue to stir in our hearts, that you would continue to draw us deeper into all that's in your heart for us and for others through us. We love you, Lord. I ask that by the power of your Holy Spirit, you would seal the truth that you've put in these men's hearts. And Lord, blow away the chaff, all those things that are superfluous. Would your seeds of truth bear much fruit in our lives. We love you, Lord. In your name.
Amen.
Amen. Guys, I want to give you a commission. And if you would like to receive this commission, I'd invite you to join me on your knees before our King. So man, I want to commission you according to 1 Corinthians 16:13 and 14. Be on your guard. Stand firm in the faith. Be strong. Be courageous. And do everything in love.
Yes.
And also according to Galatians 5, verse 1, it is for freedom that Christ has set us free. Stand firm then, and don't let yourself be burdened again by the yoke of slavery to sin.
Yes. Hallelujah.
And all God's men said,
hoorah!
Awesome. Men, thank you so much.
Thank you.
For investing today.